Hello, my dear friends. Welcome to Master Investor special edition today, Kung Flu edition. Controversial we are these days, but I am known to be a contrary investor.
Oh, wait one moment.
A contrary investor is who I am, and for that reason I actually have very few followers. There are actually very few investors that invest or contrarian, because being contrarian is very difficult. You always have hate on you. People don't like what you say, I'm also not known to be very tactful and very diplomatic in my wordings. I'm actually confrontational, and so due to that, I tend to like have like half of the people that start following me unfollow me quite quickly, or in the next turn of the market. But that is not because of a poor performance. It is because people have a very hard time with the things that I say and hate it for the most part. But if you are watching my work and following my work, especially for some time, then you've proven not to be thin-skinned and are able to look at different viewpoints and not feel offended easily. And so that's really actually an accomplishment of you. And I think the people that follow me and the investors that follow me for a while are of high quality on average. And I hope you also speak up more in the comment section, because in the comment section of my YouTube channel and of my Twitter, very often actually it's trolls that respond much more than people that actually think in the same way as I do. And please do comment and do give your opinion, because it helps people that watch my videos, because most people are not independent thinkers. They take truth from their peers. And so whatever their peers say, they stand to believe more, and they don't go to the fundamentals to judge themselves, the situation. So for that reason, it is important to not see only my ideas being trashed in the comment section, or other stupid ideas or unthoughtful ideas or bad investment ideas be promoted in the comment section. That's really not good for the people that watch my work. So I really hope that you guys start to participate a little bit more here, and only temporary, only for now, because now it's a critical time. The markets are crazy. We've never seen such a panic since 2008. Most investors never saw anything like this. It's a total worldwide panic, and it's very hard to invest and do the right thing. Because, well, 99% of people are really like doing the wrong thing, and there is very strong pressure to do so, and a lot of fear. So once the markets turn around and we bounce out of this, you can go back to just being a lurker of my work, and your comments are not actually of that high of a value, but today they are. So I hope you participate a little bit more, especially if you have, if you are a courageous, independent investor who is investing strong today in the markets, I hope, and who is not stashing cash or gold or bonds, or but is really like willing to like risk. Take risks today, then please speak up a little bit more in the YouTube comments and in the live show, and also on Twitter. For example, yesterday I posted just a simple post giving the facts of how many people die from the normal flu in only the United States the past half year. Just posting that, which is shocking to know, it's like 50,000 people died the past half year in the United States alone from the flu. People find that very disturbing that I post that. Like, how? It's just some facts. Why is that disturbing? Because people take offense that you even dare to compare the Kung Flu with the normal flu. or that you would call the Kung flu, the Wuhan flu, the Kung flu is racist. And if you even call the coronavirus the Wuhan flu, is offensive. Like, the people are super, super edged on their tips, the toes of their tips about this, and are extremely scared to catch this virus and to die in the streets and to kill, wipe out their whole families. Like, it's just, it's gone absolutely crazy. Huh? So we need some reason here, so that you can invest also better. So this is a master investor. So I review portfolios, and if you look back at the previous Master Investor episode 2 and episode 1, you will see that my advice has been very, very good. If people would have followed my advice, they would have done very well. So, and that's extremely difficult in climates like this. So I hope that my track record also gets taken into account when you judge my advice. As well as, of course, the arguments I give is very important. Welcome to the live show, all. And let me first take a look at the comments here. No, let me first do some portfolio reviews, because that's the most important thing in the end. The way your portfolio is composed will totally decide your returns, not whatever you whatever talk you you do, or whatever thoughts you have. It doesn't matter, your thoughts or your considerations. The only thing that counts is how's your portfolio composition. It doesn't matter how much money you have, but how much percent is invested in stocks, how much percent in crypto, how much percent in cash, how much percent in gold. That will totally decide your future performance for the next few months, because it probably will make a big difference already in the next few months. So let me take the first portfolio that was shared here on Twitter when I announced a couple days back that we would have this show. So D. Eli sharing that he has 40% in Ethereum, 15% in Bitcoin Cash, Bitcoin Core, 30% in stocks, so that's about 55% crypto, 30% stocks, and 15% cash. Interesting, of course, is that since the last episode, the markets have totally crashed. That was not the case in previous episode. And for example, this person, D. Eli, has also shared his portfolio from last episode. There he was not 55% crypto, but he was actually 60% crypto. So you see, this is not good. The markets have crashed. That means today you should have a higher exposure to crypto or stocks, or like your favorite crypto, your favorite stocks should have a higher exposure today than before the crash. That's the right way to invest. So that's not the case here. Stocks, he used to have before the crash 20%, but today he has 30% stocks. So there, indeed, he doubled his stocks he had, because that 20% stocks was cut in half to maybe, or no, let's say it's about 15% stocks, depending on what kind of stocks he has, exposure, but he raised it to 30%, so he doubled up his stock portfolio. That's very good. And of course, he bought some crypto also, because before the crash it was 60%, and after the crash, it's still 55%. So actually, he did buy also crypto. So he did the right moves. Before the crash, he had 20% cash, and now he has only 15% cash, 15% cash. So of course, actually, he did the right moves. My recommendation here would be to get rid of the cash ASAP. ASAP. You don't have to wait to try to buy lower. That's really not the right strategy here. Yes, there is a chance it will go lower, but valuations are already extremely undervalued for cryptocurrency and for stocks also. Extreme undervaluation for high quality companies such as Tesla, but for, like, tons of companies are selling for pennies on the dollars, like cruise companies that offer cruises, airlines, even oil companies with the oil crash. That happened as well. But especially, I don't like commodity companies so much, but especially like airlines, cruise companies. Are people going to stop flying? Are people going to stop taking cruises? Of course not. But they are discounted at 70% or some more. People think these companies will all go broke, but that's not true. Maybe some will go broke. You do some research, you'll find out which have a high chance to go broke, which not. And you buy those that have not a high chance to go broke. And that's what you do with the cash you have today. That's what you need to do. Huh? It is not the climate today to stash cash. It's the climate today to be fully invested and preferably even have some loans, have some extra, take some margin if you can, of course, with calculated risks there. But at current valuations, there is a very low chance the market will again be cut by 30%. It just lost 30%. The chance that it loses another 30% is extremely low. Huh? So that way you can actually play with leverage, take margin loans, because you have to just look at risk reward. Okay, what's the chance that it gets cut again by 30% or by 50%? It's very low. Let's say 10%. Huh? Or let's be generous. Let's give that 20%. Okay, how much more return do I have by taking out a loan? For example, for 10% of my portfolio, or for 10% or 20% or 30% of the value of my stocks, and invest also in the stock market. And when will I get margin called? This now is the time to do these calculations, because now it pays off. Now it will very likely pay off big time, but probably not in 2 months or 4 months when the market has bounced out of this too late. So. Cash really should be invested today. And okay, maybe you feel bad now. Oh, I was too late with crypto. It's already at 170 billion now, 180 billion. The low was 120 billion a week back. Eh? It bounces quickly. A couple days back, I did a live show. Eh? Do you buy the blood and the panic? Crypto was only 150 billion. Now it's 170 billion, 180 billion. Bitcoin Core is not 5K anymore. It's 6K now. Bitcoin Cash is not $180 anymore. It's now $220. So these things go up fast, but current valuation are still extreme undervaluation. If you look at the 180 billion compared to the fair value, we're still over 50% undervalued. So if you haven't bought enough crypto yet, now is the time to spend to invest that cash in crypto. If you feel bad about buying now, considerably higher than last week, well, buy stocks. They are at all-time low still. Huh? The last week was again a total crash week. Even Friday, the week ended in a total bloody crash. So stocks and indexes are at all-time lows. All these companies I talk about, that's where your cash should go on Monday, tomorrow. Huh? Don't wait with that. And if the market crashes more, okay, look for cash somewhere else. Look for loans. But it's not a time to have cash anymore. Huh? So that's my review of DLI. You can always, like, if the market crashes more, then you can, for example, look at margin loans. Even in crypto, you can get margin loans these days. You can lock your Ethereum in the DAI thing there, and flip the DAI for US dollars. And that way you can get margin loans against Ethereum, for example. And of course, now people are scared to do that because everybody just got flushed out. Eh? They were playing some great Ponzi schemes there in Ethereum. Many people leveraging their Ethereum up as prices went up more and more, taking loans more and more against their Ethereum, having margin calls quite close to the market price. And then the market price tanks. Above their expectation, they all get flushed out, margin called, their Ethereum get forcibly sold, and that's why we also likely went to only $90 for Ethereum, which is really low. But now people are scared to do that. But actually, now is the time to do that, not before. Now that the time market has crashed, now that everybody thinks it will go lower, now is the time to actually get margin loans against your cryptocurrency, huh? And use that money, because the chance is low that, what is it now, Ethereum, $140. You can set your margin call price at, for example, Ethereum at, let's say, $50 or $80. What is the chance that price will be hit again? very low. Maybe it's like 20%. You could give it even a 50% chance, and you will still see that it makes sense to do that. From a risk reward perspective, it makes sense to risk borrowing money against your Ethereum, for example. And invest more in the market, maybe not in crypto. You can use that money also to invest in the stock market. But this you don't have to do today, but you could do it if the market crashes more, then you can do that. But now you should have all your cash fully invested. All right, El Professor, 75% Ethereum, 25% Chainlink. So 100% invested in cryptocurrency. Congratulations, I think that's the right portfolio here. However, Chainlink, I really don't believe in that project simply because of the leader, Sergey. I think he's in it just for the money. He has he's not driven by ideals and to make the world a better place. And I don't think that's good enough. Also, Chainlink pumped tremendously and already went a lot up in market ranking in the cryptocurrency world. And that's just too late. It's just too late. And it's also not a thing to hold, because even if you were in time and you made tons of money with this project, it doesn't have strong fundamentals. So if you take your money out, you can leave maybe a little bit in, but you should really like invest that in other projects, in my opinion. But other than that, really good portfolio. It's 75% Ethereum, but Ethereum is like investing in Bitcoin 5 years back. I mean, it's the market leader. Bitcoin Core very likely to lose that position. Ethereum, from a risk reward perspective, I think is the best investment in the cryptocurrency world. So you can have a high exposure to that. Mindful Penguin says that he has 60% Ethereum, 15% Zcash, 10% Tezos, 10% XRP, and 5% Link, Chainlink. So 100% crypto, very good in my opinion at current valuations. Also 60% Ethereum and then some other coins, Zcash, Tezos, Ripple. But Link, for example, is only 5%. I think that's much better than 25%. And Tezos, quality project, Zcash, extremely cheaply valued. You can take certainly bets on that. So great portfolio, I think. One Grain, One Sausage has 100% Ethereum short. I don't know if that's even serious. I don't think that's serious. Like, it seems like, looks like a joke to me. How can you have your whole portfolio invested, not in Ethereum long, but in Ethereum short? That seems totally ridiculous to me. Cryptocurrency has just crashed a lot. Ethereum valuations are very low. And being the short crypto today is not wise. Being short stocks today is not wise. You missed your shorting opportunity. I was thinking of going short before the market crash. I didn't get to it. I was was too much work for me because I wasn't familiar with shorting yet. And I just didn't want to put more work in my investment stuff, as I have also other obligations, such as family, my girlfriends, my children. So I skipped that. But to be short today is ridiculous. It's really unwise. I mean, on stocks and on crypto, that's really the wrong portfolio. And especially if you're 100% like short, One Grain, One Sausage has been following my work for years, and then he posts this. It's like a joke to me. What else do we have? I will take a look at the comments here. And I will only read the comments that I want to reply to. Please, only English today. All Dutch comments will be muted forever. Huh? The accounts that post Dutch and other languages. So about my own portfolio, yes, I the first time I bought call options, Chris asks, did you end up doing that? Yes, I did that. I copied Jack Rickard, because actually I never bought options in my life. I don't even know how they work, call and put options. So I had to like try to understand that. And I'm being greedy here. Like I buy like a crazy person, like a nutcase, like I'm really buying because, yeah, the market is clearly fearful. So be greedy when others are fearful. when the market is fearful, be greedy. That's the right thing, because actually opportunities, the best opportunities go by with like this quickly. So you really do have to seize that day. Yes, it may prove to be that I bought too soon. We'll have to see that. But when it comes to these calls, I just copied someone, Jack Rickert, who has proven in the past to make great market calls, but also to really be very good with options. For example, he's been a long Tesla bull, and right before the takeoff, when Tesla half a year ago started to go up and would likely go up a lot, he was very smart to sell some Tesla shares and to buy, what was it then? I think it was put options then. And thanks to that, he made much higher returns than just going long, even with leverage. Like he did a 10x or so with his portfolio. Crazy, huh? Crazy. He succeeded in that. Or maybe it was a 7x with his portfolio. So you could never have achieved that with just being long Tesla. So he did very good moves there. He knows what he does. So I just copied his portfolio. I sold some. He did the same today. Actually, he went also fully to cash before the crash. Another great call of him. And then he started buying recently. You should really watch his video also to have a more calm view on this whole Wuhan flu panic. He really looks at it from a very different perspective and is a very informed and wise man. I really recommend highly to watch that video where he shares his portfolio, that he finally went back into the market. I find this also very funny guy. But he went back in the market because he can't stand it. It's like just unbelievable how crazy markets go. So he ended up buying call options for way out of the money options, that's called. And the strike price is at the all-time high. So for example, for Tesla, he called, he bought call options for June. So already in expiring in 2 months or so. But also in September, expiring in half a year, at $1,000. And for example, these trading currently at $15. So what does that mean? It means that if you buy that, you buy the right from the other person to buy in September, in half a year, Tesla at $1,000. Now, today you would say, like, who would want to buy the right to buy Tesla at $1,000? Currently, it's only like $400. So how is that even a right? And already, okay, maybe in 5 years it will be over $1,000. And if you can buy it then at $1,000, oh, that's probably a good deal. Because maybe it will be $2,000 or $3,000 then. And wow, and you only pay $15 today to do that, to be able to buy that $1,000. But yeah, it's already in half a year that it's expiring. Is that a good idea? Because what are the chances that Tesla will recover to and make a new all-time high in only half a year, $2,000, because the all-time high was $950. What are the chances, considering current climate, where it just dropped more than half to $400 or $360? It's at $400 now. What are the chances that in half a year it will be over $1,000? Because only when it's over $1,000 you make money. Well, the chance is low. But how low? The price is only $15 to buy that right. If it goes to, for example, if it goes to $1,150 by that time, you buy it for $15, but you make a profit of $150, so you 10x'd your money. If it is at $1,150, you 10x your money because you pay $15 today and you make $150 then. That's a big return. Chance is low, but if it does happen, you make a 10x, but it can be a lot higher too by that time. It could be 1,300 or 1,600, 1,900, it's like a 40-50x. Please correct me if I'm wrong in my calculations here, because I might certainly be. I'm not so experienced with these call options. So, for example, for me, betting 10% of my portfolio on options like this, where I can like 10x and more my money, If indeed the market recovers strongly, is a good bet to take, I believe, but not with too much of my portfolio. For example, he invested 20% of his portfolio now in these options. I don't dare to do that, but I do half or a little bit more. I did like 12% or so. So yeah, these are the kind of like things I think are worth bets that are worth taking. Let us see at all the comments. Welcome all to the live show, Master Investor Wuhan Flu Edition. But just to comment on the Wuhan flu panic. So people justify the strong panic, and people are really afraid to catch it because of the overload of the medical system. And that's true. That's also why I'm very careful not to catch it. I am also in self-isolation. I don't want to end up in hospitals that are overloaded and die because I don't even get basic equipment like a respirator or something. No. So it's very smart to protect yourself. But does that mean it's wise to shut down all your work activities, or for politicians to shut down all businesses, or to forcefully forbid people to leave their house or to come together even in groups? I'm not so sure that's a wise approach. Like, you really harm a lot of people by, for example, closing all pubs, closing all restaurants. A lot of people depend on that's their livelihood. And people that, and there are many jobs dependent on that. And people that have jobs usually don't have much savings. So when suddenly like all these sport events are canceled forcefully, but not only forcefully, it's like also it's a panic shared by many people. Like, we are all guilty of that. We all do it, one more than the other, by really canceling things and stopping in economic activity. But yeah, if many people depend on you, they get no money. Well, they go into poverty. That actually causes a lot of medical issues also. So you have to be wise and balanced in your approach. And at the beginning, I was also panicked, but I'm starting to really it's really smart, I think, to, for example, protect yourself, but to stop participating in important economic activities, I don't think it's so smart. You also have to look at the country you're in, for example, in Asia, in China, Singapore, South Korea, Taiwan, like the peak is long past. So people are coming out there again. Life is back to normal. Okay, people are more careful, but yeah, it's also like if you catch it there now, you have good medical support because they are on top of it now. That's not the case yet in Europe and in America, where you're still in front of that curve, and Italy is indeed very, very bad. How many people die there? But we also have to like keep it real here. Italy, the average age of people dying is 70 years, above 70 years. So I mean, why don't they say that in the news? Like, you should say that every time if you talk about, wow, people are dying en masse in Italy. Yes, but what's their age? If it's the average age is 70, average age. That means that most people are like 80 plus, and then you have some people that are like 40, and maybe one or so that is 20. Like, and so what's the average age of people dying in Italy? It's 80 years old. So it's almost the same. So I mean, it's the same as what happens with a normal flu. A normal flu causes lots of deaths too. But what people then usually say, the people that die from it usually are old or have serious medical issues. So it's actually the flu is just the last drip in the bucket that causes them to die. So this is also like the case with this virus. Yes, it's much more worse than a normal flu if you catch it in some cases. But for most people, it's not much worse than the flu. They don't even notice they have it, or a small cough or a small fever. So it's really the global panic. And most people should not panic. Like when you're 20 years old, when you're 40 years old, like me, the chance to die from this is 0.2%. It's very low. So there's no reason for us to panic. But if you're old, yes, you should be extremely careful. So that's why you should put this a little bit into context. So to shutting down countries and borders and the economy causes much more harm here. If this is continued, then actually the Wuhan flu can cause the kind of harm it can cause, and we saw already in the past, like in Asia, how they responded and the effects of it. We saw in China how they responded, totally incompetent, first denying it, same as in Europe and America. Most people totally denying it. When I was making videos about it 2 months ago, people didn't take it serious. Same in China, totally denying it, even censoring it. But then, of course, because people take no precautions whatsoever, then it spreads like a virus, and then suddenly there are many people that have it, and that overloads the medical system, and then and people are not like tracing down people that actually have it and isolating the people that have it. No, that's not happening. And so that's a very poor response that you now also see in Europe and in America. In Singapore, for example, you see a much better, they did that much better in South Korea also. And that's really missing in Europe and America. But even though that's missing in Europe and America, well, what will happen there is likely what will happen in China. There will be a few regions that are affected. But of course, it's later than in China. I mean, it's not a communist government in the West, so they do things a little bit better. And I think it will not be as bad as what happened in Wuhan. But people are really afraid of that. Anyways. Let's go back to investing. But this is, of course, very important to see. Like there are all kind of predictions today that, and these are medical predictions, that it will get much worse and it will be a wipeout and it will become, many people will die. That's just a total scaremongering and it's not based in reality. Yes, we see a continued exponential rise in amount of infected people in Europe and America and some regions in the world still. But that will extremely likely already drop in a week or 2 weeks. We will see that the exponential rise stops simply because of all the draconian measures that have been taken the past week, shutting down whole countries and whole economies. Yes, then the and people in panic and not doing anything anymore, totally self-isolating, that will of course cause the Wuhan flu to spread a lot less. So that's very likely to happen already in 2 weeks. And you have to prepare in your portfolio for that. You cannot wait, I think, to see the evidence that it's indeed flattening out in Europe and in America and the exponential growth is over before you invest. That's really not the right strategy, in my opinion. You have to invest at the peak of the panic because that's where the valuations are the lowest. And I believe that we are there or very close to it. Camera is super shaky. I'm sorry. Let me put that thing down. All right. The difference is that the Wuhan flu is exponential in the West, while the normal flu is not. It's not true. The normal flu is also exponential when it's flu season. And it's good to call it the Wuhan flu because it is part of the flu family. Coronavirus is actually the family of flus. The viruses that cause flus. That's why coronavirus is the wrong name. It's a group of viruses. This is a specific virus, but it's part of that group. So you have to give it a specific name. COVID-19 or so is a scientific name. It's not a name that sticks. It's very important to name the virus correctly, and the tradition in naming viruses, where did it originate? Because that's what people always will remember. We all know it started in Wuhan. Nobody knows Wuhan. Only Chinese people know Wuhan and business people, but now we all know Wuhan. Yeah, Wuhan is where the disaster started, where they've been eating dogs, cats, and bats, like in the whole of China, and a very poor eating habits, and that's what caused this very likely. Huh? So we remember it's from Wuhan, and we remember why it happened, and it's for the Chinese to change. Huh? That's how you do that with virus. The Ebola virus was called to the Ebola River because that's where it started. And when you go visit and you suddenly see that river, you remember, oh, Ebola River, okay, wow. Actually, this is where there was at the time a virus coming from here that caused quite some harm, and you want to know the story, you're going to learn a lesson. Huh? So that's why naming an epidemic or pandemic virus correctly is very important, and not go with the propaganda of the day that the Chinese and our Western governments put out. And also have flu in the name is very important. It makes it more like real, because indeed it is some kind of flu, huh? Which also like puts it more into perspective. Huh? Yes, it's a bad flu, but it's a flu. Mm-hmm. So Guillermo says, I was watching your last video while going all in, but this pump catched me. I am very pissed. I bought only 10% of my crypto, what I was planning to buy. What should I do now? Wait or buy? It is so hard. Yeah, that sucks, and I'm sorry. I really hate that also when you want to buy something and then you're preparing for it and the price runs away. I hate that too. That's why I am a greedy buyer when market makes all-time low, and I really prepare for it as much as possible because I've had that many times before and I really want to avoid that. And it's very difficult what to advise here. But I think go back to your portfolio allocation. At the time, it depends on your time horizon, but when you're a long-term investor, you have to look at it long-term. And I believe that crypto right now, yes, it sucks, it went up a bit. But yeah, if you only have 10% of your preferred allocation, you should buy a lot more at the higher prices. And you should at least have 50% locked in. Yeah, you can then put some other orders lower, but you have to know that you take the risk to be left behind. Huh? So it's a difficult thing, it's very difficult. Huh? Sometimes it's wise to buy still at a higher price and not try to buy lower. Especially in the current climate, I think... Yeah, I would go higher than 50%, maybe 80% or 75%. I would buy and make sure I have that, and maybe try to buy the other one lower or shift to other opportunities. That's actually also a good idea. Like instead of investing then so much in crypto, invest a little bit in things that have are at all time lows or really like what I discussed about before. That may be a better idea. Invest some money in these cruise or airlines or in these calls maybe that are shared by Jack Richards or Tesla, like other investments that are still at the very close to their lows. That's another idea. Where are you right now? I'm in Kenya, Africa, and life these days is better here than in Europe and America. But there's only 7 infected in Kenya. It may still become a pandemic here too. We'll have to see how that goes. Looking at the comments. Someone, Philip asked, what do you think about bank shares, bank stocks? I don't know, I haven't studied it, but I don't think that the opportunity is there here. Like, it's not a financial crisis. It's not 2008 financial crisis. Then certain bank stocks, like, they all dropped more than 90%. The ones that would survive, it was a very good idea to buy. But this is not the kind of crisis we are in today. Yeah? We are in a very different crisis. So today I would look at cruise companies and airlines and also like restaurant chains and all that, that get really affected by this crisis, and hotel chains. Because they will likely, like they are like 70% down or more, and they will likely recover a lot once this thing settles, flies over. Because many people will get out, eh? Like all the people, the staying inside, self-isolation or forced isolation, people later make up for that. Eh? They're gonna be going out a lot more, fly more, go to hotels more, go on cruise ships more. If they haven't done it for 3 months or 6 months, these businesses will all pick up very, very hard again. Hi, D Zono shares that he's all in crypto. But then he has like many cryptos, say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and he has only a small capital. Huh? Well, I think too many cryptos here. Eh? You have to cut out 10 or half of them, huh? And also you still have 10% cash, so you should invest that too. So I really would like cut it back. It's too much. 7. If you don't have much capital, you certainly don't have to be like diversified. You should pick 2, 3 projects max that you really believe in. And you invest in that, and then you also work in these projects and you try to earn crypto in these projects. That's how you can make a fortune, huh? In crypto, if you want. Let's look at the other portfolios and comments. Yeah, what about don't catch a falling knife? Or someone else comments, I think stocks will go down another 50%. Sure, it can happen, but what's the probability? Look at my recent tweets. Very good videos are being made. The chance is very, very low that we will see that happening. Stocks drop another 50%. What about don't catch a falling knife? I think that's the worst investment advice you can give. Don't catch a falling knife. It's like saying don't buy discounts in the shop. Eh? It's that's really not my investment strategy. This comes from technical trading. This advice, but as a value investor, I don't think you should think like that. Yes, if you have a strict technical trading methodology, then you can apply this rule not to catch falling knives. But very few people are advanced technical traders that stick to a proven methodology. This is for professional traders, huh? So this kind of advice is not applicable to most investors. We are passive investors here. Most people here investing have jobs or companies that they run. It's not their full-time job investing. And then you have to approach things as a value investor. It's much smarter. On average, like, there are many more people that make money with value investing than with technical trading. It's much harder to make money with technical trading. So being a value investor is wise, and that means yes, you do catch falling knives. Yes, and the harder they fall, the more you buy. That's buying value. Huh? That's what Warren Buffett actually finally can do today with his 100 billion cash stash. He can buy value today. There is a lot of real value in the market. And yes, it's crashed and it's a falling knife and it's crashed 70% or more. Yes, you buy that because if it looks like it's not going to go broke, you buy that falling off with pleasure. It's what you need to do, because the as fast as it drops, as fast it can go back up, and you don't want to be chasing price. That's the alternative. That's what technical traders do. They want to see the price go back up, see confirmation, and only then they will be buying. But that's a strategy you can do with small amounts of capital, or when you're very advanced, you can do it with larger amount of capital spread over more of different markets. But it's difficult emotionally actually to do that. Also, I find it much easier emotionally for me to buy something that's really going down a lot than something that has started to go back up again. But that's a personal preference. Jack Rickert, check my Twitter, is from EVTV, has a great YouTube channel, an old guy, but a funny guy, and good investor, very good investor. Jack Rickert, EVTV, electrical vehicle television, EVTV on YouTube. Rickert, check Rickert. Yeah, you check my Twitter. Twitter is publicly viewable. You don't need an account, right? So, can you share what you did for your family in preparation of the Wuhan flu? Galapiat. I started self-isolation a couple weeks ago, or maybe almost a month ago, with my family, with my two girlfriends and two babies. We don't see friends and family anymore, and if we don't do shopping anymore, we do have someone to shop for us. But people that work in the house have to wear masks. If we go out somewhere where we really have to go, like we had to go to a hospital, we try to pick a very small hospital. We go in only the person that needs to go in. That was my girlfriend, and she's fully wearing protective gear, which is a mask, even glasses. Once you come out to hospital, take all clothes off, put them in a bag before you go in the car. So if the virus is somewhere on the clothes, that you don't bring it in the home. When you come in the home, always sanitize hands and also mouth area. So I have hand sanitizers that we use a lot. So all these kind of things we do. And of course, stashed food supplies and toilet paper beforehand, knowing the craze of people. When people start panicking, you might not have food for a while. But I think we've seen all of that. To prepare for that now is a bit late. I think right now you can go the other way, and you should really like not go with the panic of the day, but really look at the actual risks here. And actually, there's money, lots of money to be made, not just as investors in this market by buying now when everybody's freaked out, but for many other things too, like many jobs people don't want to do right now because they are afraid to catch the virus. But they're 20 years old, 30 years old, it doesn't matter they catch the virus. Like, chances is that they will have serious, I mean, I'm exaggerating here. It's not a big problem if they catch the virus. Chance that they will die from it is much lower than, say, for example, not have an income and lose your house, and due to that maybe lose your deposit down that you've been saving for 5 years or 10 years. That will cost you a lot more economical harm, and therefore also medical problems in the future, than catching the Wuhan flu for a 20-year-old or 30-year-old. So doing certain kind of jobs today may pay off big time, or like starting to think differently today, like planes are empty, hotels are empty, cruise ships are empty. Probably you can do these things at great discounts, travel today. And people are afraid to get the Wuhan flu, but you'll probably be sitting on an empty plane or an empty cruise ship. It's all for you. Like, this is the situation today. So start to think differently than what the masses do. It's usually very profitable. You can take very... but do what the masses do right now. Try to buy hand sanitizers today, too late. Eh? You're going to pay lots of money or stand in line where you catch the virus or yeah. So you really have to be ahead of the crowd. That's so important that I was considering of rebranding my YouTube channel to ahead of the pack, because it comes always down to that. You have to be ahead of the pack if you want to make money in the markets, but also if you want to prepare for certain things. So you have D3 Barbari, someone who's been following my channel also for years and posting very, very bearish comments on my YouTube channel and my comment section here, predicting that we go in a recession, depression now, BTC will go to below $1,000, $500. This is really not what I recommend follow, the kind of advice to follow. That's also what I predicted would happen, that many people would start talking like that. Once we test the bottom for crypto, which we just did at $3,800, most people will start to predict that we will break it and that we will go lower to $1,000 and stuff. So that's typical for where we are in the cycle, but you should really not fall for that. You also have to know that actually not only in the professional world, but also in the amateur world of investors, you have lots of trolls, people that actually post the inverse of what they believe to mislead people. But the investment banks do that often too, like Morgan Sachs and Goldman. They post reports that they know it's like total bullshit, just the inverse of what they believe. Like a month ago or so, was it JP Morgan or so made a bullish call like... Tesla just dropped from the all-time high of 950 to 700 to 750. At the start of the Wuhan flu, and they put a report out. They think Tesla will go to 1,000 or 1,200 or whatever. Suddenly they are bullish. They always been bearish. Suddenly they are bullish, right at the time when it's time to actually offload your shares because it was clearly something heading our way that would crash the markets. They push out, put out bullish reports to just offload their positions. Huh? But the same is happening here in the crypto market. In these comment sections, you have to be very careful for people, their opinions, because some people really post the inverse of what they believe. They're just playing games. Huh? They are not truthful at all. It also happens, but actually it's the exception. Most people actually are bearish at the bottom and very bullish at the top, and they mean what they say. Let me look at the comments. Do some more reviews here of portfolios on Twitter. Buy the fucking dip dot Ethereum posted this portfolio. 70% crypto, 10% stocks, and 20% cash to buy the fucking dip. But, you know, the dip is there. What do you want? What kind of dip do you want? This is, we are at valuation, the stock market of 3 years ago when Trump was elected. We are in a bull market, so that's very rare to go to valuations that are like already 3 years old or so. In crypto, we are at undervaluation, all seen two times before and now a little bit higher, but still like we are at extreme undervaluation and we're in 2020 here. The bull market comes closer and closer. So what do you expect? Like there is, if there is ever a dip, it's this. So there should not be cash here in a portfolio to buy the fucking dip. That should be gone. So that's my advice for you. Buy the fucking dip dot Ethereum on Twitter. And other than that, 10% stock, 70% crypto is very good. Crypto, Rito. Rito says that he has 30% crypto, he has also 20% precious metals and 50% cash. Well, but then he says that actually, yeah, that's what he says. I don't think this is a good portfolio, Rito. what he actually says is that he has 30% crypto, but actually he has like he's 50% long and then 20% short in crypto. Huh? So that means that he makes money with 20% of his portfolio when crypto goes down, and then he makes money with 50% of his portfolio when crypto goes up. So net, he is like 30% long. So for me, I don't understand why people do that. Why? Oh, actually, no, he is arbitraging. Yeah, in that case, yes, he's actually making money on buy and sell arbitrage between exchanges. So if the price is different on different exchanges, he transfers monies between them to make that small amount of money. Actually, that's a very good business, especially in crypto, where market prices sometimes are very different between exchanges because the supply is not enough. We saw this recently. For example, Kraken, Bitstamp, much higher price for example, Bitcoin Cash, usually $10 more than other exchanges. And you can really make money by doing arbitrage. So good, very good, actually. But the problem with these things is that the amount of money that you make is a little bit at a constant rate. So you make a little bit all the time with these kind of setups or having buy and sell orders close to the market to fill in. And these kind of things make a little bit of money over time and a little bit of money a long time. Is also a lot of money, but the problem is you can make a lot more money with passive investing, with value appreciation at certain points in time of the market. And it's not worth it to lock your money into these kind of businesses that make a little bit of money. And so I think right now is not a good time to really do that, to make money with arbitrage, for example. Even though, yes, of course you can make money with it, but there is much more money to be made here when you look at the amount of energy you also need to put in with just being long crypto. So I would say stop this business for a while, arbitrage. Don't have that 20% short. Thanks to that, you don't need that. And you can go just 50% long crypto. I think that's a much better idea than only be 30% long crypto. So that's the first thing. Precious metals can go now. Like, this is the best time to sell your gold, silver. It just pumped. It's misguided why people pumped it. They think this will protect them against the Wuhan flu. No, it's clearly not. The price is not strong. Like, it was unable to break its all-time, to break the all-time high, despite all the panic in the world. And it's clear it's going to go down a lot, very likely. But the valuations are still very high today. Actually, silver just crashed to the floor. That's too late. But gold not. So you should really sell that here. It's really, you should not have PMs in your portfolio if the goal is to make money. If the goal is to protect your capital against every climate, okay, you should have that. But if the goal is to make money, you should not have that, because the risk reward of precious metals is very bad for the next 20 years. So I would recommend to sell that, and cash 50% is way too much. So Rito, I think you have a very bad portfolio. You should really change that. You should be long, and not precious metals. Like, basically the only good investment you have right now is 30% crypto. That means 70% of your portfolio, the majority, is not well invested. I hope you change that. Primo Value, a long-time follower, 20% cash, 20% Pax, which is gold. But I think it's gold in the crypto world, some coin backed by gold. Yeah. And then you have also a 60% ETF, ZKB, that is an ETF that has physical gold. So he has 80% in gold and 20% in cash. And he says that he does not care to be insulted, because I sit... that all those that have big cash positions or big gold or big bond position will be insulted. And then I asked him, okay, give me some more ammunition to insult you. What's your track record? And he did not reply to that. But that's very important. So he has a portfolio that I think is a very bad portfolio, 80% gold and 20% cash. Like, gold will go down in value very likely, and cash doesn't, like, there's a this is the time to deploy cash. So I think in 1 year, 2 years time, this will be losses. If it's not changed, he will sit on serious losses, whereas he could be sitting by then on big gains, but he will not, in my opinion. So I think it's a big waste of opportunity. And his track record, maybe he replied somewhere else to that. I don't know. But it's very important to judge this. If somebody has a very different opinion, a very different portfolio, okay, check his performance. Because if his performance is very good, that's, well, should be researched better. But if his track record is not good, if his returns are, for example, 10% per year, the same as just being in a stock index, basically, or like making like a few percent after inflation and expenses, like, it's a waste of time. You should do another profession. Like, it's just, you're not a good investor. And that's likely the case here. And so, yeah, if he would show me that, oh, he has a great track record, he has had really great returns, okay, then we have to like go deeper into this. But right now, he doesn't share his track record, even though I asked his average return per year. So I have to assume it's bad, and this portfolio is the reason why his track record is likely bad, is because he makes the wrong investments. People don't need more gold in the future. They don't need more gold. Who wants more gold next year or in 5 years? Who is going to stash your gold, buy your gold? If they don't even buy it today, when the world is totally panicked and afraid that the global system will collapse and we'll get martial law, if they don't buy it now, if you don't make a new all-time high today, it's not going to happen. So it's a very bad investment. You invest in something that people won't need in the future. All right, so another last portfolio here on Twitter. He says he's 99% in Bitcoin Core, 1% in Bitcoin Cash. And that's since 2012. He has a compound annual growth rate of 90% per year. Since 2012, he has almost doubled his portfolio every year. So this is a great example of a hodler, someone who has bought early. My baby girl is up, so the live show is coming to an end. Hey, baby, because I'm alone with her. So one moment, guys, I have to take care of her. Oh, well, alles goed? Here she is, just waking up. Huh? You lekker geslapen? Did you sleep well? Huh? Yeah? I'm gonna have to give her some something to drink. One moment. I think I should end the call, guys. I think big congrats to the last portfolio. I will go through the chat and I will discuss those questions in the next call. I'm sorry I was not able to get to that. But congrats, Dean, for your very low stress portfolio, he calls it. He's very happy with the results, and a big congrats. And I think that's what you need to do today. Invest big in crypto and then just hodl it for the next 3-4 years. You're going to be so happy that you did that, but you need to stash them today. You need to buy them today and lock them safely without counterparty risk. That's really what you need to do today. That's going to give you returns like this guy since 2012 has doubled his portfolio every year. That's an incredible return. And some people have achieved that in crypto, like Roger Ver, for example, also, and some others. And that's just very admirable. But for that, you need to buy big when the fear is very high. And that's what you need to do today. And then just hodl. I hope that was helpful for you guys. And I wish you all a great, adventurous week ahead.